Hello friends, welcome back to GK Code Labs. So in this video, I'm going to discuss few of the issues, the actual issues that I faced while working on a big data project. So while I was working in a big data project, there were n number of issues that I went through, or any developer can go through. So in this video, I'll be discussing selective 10 issues of them that I thought can be interesting, you can say, or maybe a good takeaway for you from this video. And maybe this can be a good interview question for you as well. You might have faced, most of the interviewers ask that, what are the few of the issues? Can you explain that, what have you faced in your project? So maybe that I thought that it's better to discuss with you what I faced when I was discussing. So in this video, I'll be discussing 10 issues. I have thousands of them, but mostly the interesting ones, or if you want, you can explain in your interviews as well. So I have made a list of it. I'll be explaining one by one. So first issue that I faced was, whenever I built the project, I coded everything, and when my application started to build, it was taking more amount of time than actually is expected. So somewhat, let's say I have written 5 classes, and while building it, it was taking somewhat around 5 to 10 minutes. So something was wrong at that time. I was not sure. So this was one of the issue, and the resolution as well. I'll give you some time to think through it, what all things could be gone wrong. You can pause this video and think throughout it. And for all my issues, it's better that whenever I explain the issue, you can pause the video and think all the possible parameters that you think may be causing this issue. So my build time was more than expected. What could be the issue? I'll give you some time, not in this video. You can pause it and think through it. The test cases that I had written at that time were all the test cases when I was reading some data and writing some data after some logic. So all that data was obviously getting written to some external storage, let's say Azure data lake. So what my code has this issue that even my test cases were testing the same class, and I have not parameterized those input and output paths. So even my test cases, when it were being tested, they also were referring to the external storage, the Azure storage. So this could be any external storage, your Azure, your Amazon S3, your Google Cloud storage, anything. So my test cases were also referring to the same external storage. So this was causing the issue that when I was building my project, my test cases were getting run, and they in itself were trying to connect with my external storage. So that were increasing the time of all the tests getting successful. My code was perfect, but anyways, those tests were taking more time because they were connecting to the external storage. So usually the good practice is that whenever you test the same classes, let's say you have built some class, and that is supposed to connect to your external storage and write the data to it. But in your test class, just try to have a config separate, and just connect to your local. So local could be some of the folder, input and output folder, in your jar itself. So that will be very much quicker, and your test cases will pass. Just the methodology of your function has to be checked, that is it writing to the correct folder. Just make some small structure into your jar file, and try to handle everything inside your test case on your local. So that was one of the issue that I was facing. Then issue number two, when I built some code and I ran it, it was running successful. But when the same code I deployed on a cluster, it was running fine there as well. But on my output, I was seeing duplicate records for a few of the classes. So whatever function I wrote, the output of that, I was seeing the duplicate records in that. How did this happen? It is running fine in my local, and on the cluster, it is giving me duplicate records. So giving you some time for that. So in my case, the issue was that I had not implemented the prerequisite checks. While running that job into the cluster, what was happening? If you remember, I have told in my multiple videos that the yarn in itself attempts multiple times. That is obviously configurable, but in case some issue is occurring, yarn, the resource manager, can attempt your job multiple times or the given number of times. So what was happening in my case, there was some configuration issue or some performance issue. Due to that, there were two attempts being done by yarn, and it was not happening in my local because that was yet another environment. So in my yarn environment or the actual cluster, the job was running with two attempts, and that was creating duplicates. So you should always remember that you should have some kind of checks, or you should limit your number of attempts in yarn. That is obviously configurable. So that was another issue. Now coming to the third issue, this happened when I was migrating my code from one storage to another storage. So my project had one requirement that initially it was working on Azure Data Lake, but later it has to be migrated to Google Cloud Storage. So what happened is I changed the configurations, obviously everything, and all the reference in the new code I gave for Google Cloud Storage. But still, when I ran the code, it was saying that some configurations are missing for Azure Data Lake storage. So even after giving everything, what happened that it is still pointing to my older storage. The issue was my default file system was still not switched to Google Cloud Storage. So that is one of the parameters that you should keep in mind. Now, the fourth issue, and this is sort of a silly mistake, or maybe it took some time for me even to figure out that time. The issue was with IntelliJ imports. So IntelliJ already provides you multiple shortcuts or multiple options to optimize your code. So what happened is I optimized my code as per IntelliJ's option, and then my code started to fail. What went wrong at that time is there is an option Control Shift Alt L that takes care of all your code indentation and unused imports. It will remove and everything. Now, but the thing I did wrong at that time was I hit this option, but my IntelliJ was not configured properly with my Scala classes. So Scala SDK basically was not properly configured. So what happened at that time, the IntelliJ did not recognize the important imports as well. So when I hit the optimize imports, it removed all the import statements. So few of them were left, but most of the important of them were removed. So as per IntelliJ, the import statement were not getting used. But why? Because the IntelliJ itself was not configured to understand those classes. So that's why it considered that as unused. So it removed it. Later when I came back to it, and I thought I never removed those. So then I came to know that what all things might have got wrong, and this was the exact issue. Now, the fifth issue, or you might say it as a challenge. What happened, one of the developers developed his code and he left for the day. Now, that was Friday, you can say, and it was urgent to get that code merged to the higher branch. Now, me and one other person were the approvers, and actually in production scenarios, there are a certain number of approvers, let's say two or three. only when they approve the code, then only it can get merged to higher environment. In our case, at that time on a Friday, only two approvers were there. Only two were required actually, but the developer that developed the code did not raise a pull request. So code was there in the feature branch, but he did not raise a pull request to merge that to a higher environment. So that was a challenge. We could not get that developer at that time. Maybe he had some of the issues. So the code is there in the feature branch and we had a team. So anyone had access to that feature branch. So we requested some of the people in our team itself that you go to that feature branch and raise a pull request for that. And we two are sitting here, we'll approve it. But the issue that we faced that time, and actually a good learning, that if someone else has developed some code in a feature branch, no one else can raise a pull request for it. So if I am developing a code, only I can raise a pull request for it. So as a workaround, what we did, the other option that clicked in my mind was that the other person can clone a branch out of what other person who was not there, he developed. He can clone another branch, the person who is available, and push that branch also to the Git repository and raise pull request for that. So that was sort of a workaround, but you should keep in mind that these sort of things happen in actual projects. Now, the sixth issue. This issue was regarding the Spark optimization related, the core and the memory configurations that we do for any Spark job. What was the issue at that time was that we configured everything as per the given cluster, the development cluster that we had. And we had to show and demonstrate what the code was doing on a release date, or you can say the demo date. So at that time, what was happening, we were running on the optimized query, but the code was not running as expected. So you can think about that. The reason in my case was that was a release date and we were getting our code optimized for a development branch. So when it comes to demo, it was a release date. Many people were trying and testing their code on the smaller scale cluster. That was a dev branch. So even if we optimized that cluster that was being used, that was not actually that job was supposed to run. So at that time, the cluster was having minimal resources and many people were testing. So that job was not performing that well as we thought of. So this thing you should keep in mind that you should always optimize your job thinking about where your code actually has to run. There are no cheat sheets that you can follow and run all the jobs and any environment flawlessly until some specific scenarios. Now, the seventh issue. We had to develop a error handling mechanism in our application. And what was happening that a few of the checks were happening, and in those checks, if any records were rejected, they were getting returned to a error folder or error data frame, you can say. But onto that, we also had to implement another logic that should also be one of the checks after those two checks. So we implemented it and the code was performing fine. It was filtering all those error records and writing to a folder. But those records also were written to the actual folder as well. I mean, those records were passing as well. They were getting written to the error as well as they were passing throughout our application. So what could be the issue in this case? Just pause the video and think. So in my case, the issue was the person has implemented another logic, the third logic, and he wrote the logic perfectly. But what he forgot to do is he forgot to change the return of that function. So in the case, it was obviously filtering out and writing to some data frame, but after all, whatever that function was returning to the application was still the older one. So after two rules, if you are applying a third rule, then the return type of that method should be the output of your third rule, not the previous one. So it will filter out, write it, and still it will return the output of previous rule, which will not have your error records. So that was the issue at that time. Now, the eighth issue that we faced, we were trying to develop an API, and that was supposed to handle most of the common applications or most of the common methods that we used across all our project. So what we did at that time was we were handling most of the exceptions that might be if this could not connect to this, we should handle it inside. And maybe let's say the output path it gave for some external drive, and if that is not existing, we'll write in our local. So some of that exceptional handling we were doing, but the issue was that whosoever is using that API, he doesn't know what we are doing. So if he entered some random output path which does not even exist, or which the authentication for which we don't even have, what will he get? He'll get nothing, because we handled it inside our API. So a better understanding and takeaway for you can be, if you are developing an API or a framework, try not to catch any exceptions. Just throw it as and when it occurs. Don't catch any exception and don't try to handle any exception, because the person who is using your API, he is using as the basic minimal feature that you are providing. He is not interested for you to do something for him when it comes to some of his inputs. So don't try to catch or fix any exceptions inside your API or framework. That was one of the learning that I learned at that time. Now, another issue that I faced, when I cloned a repo in my IntelliJ, local IntelliJ, the code was working fine for many of my teammates, but it was not working fine for me. And we have cloned the same repo. What went wrong? Just think about that. So, issue in my case was that there are many config files and many of the build tool related files. Let's say for Scala, there is SBT. So for Maven, there could be many other files. Usually most of the important files are always pushed. That is a standard practice. But there, in my case, it was the issue that one file was missing from being pushed. And the other teammates that had, they had pulled another repo before that, as a part of which that file they had already. And they didn't even know that they copied into the same repository. So in their local, that code was working fine, but not for me. So I saw the differences between what they had, what I had. And it was a simple SBT file. That was SBT options file that was missing, and I added that and I re-imported my SBT and it started working. So that was one of the small issue that I faced. Now, another issue that I faced, I was working with the two external environments, Azure Data Lake and Google Cloud Storage. So I did all the configurations for Azure Data Lake and same all the configurations of Google Cloud Storage in my code. But when I was running my code into the cluster, it was working fine with the Azure Data Lake storage, but it wasn't working for Google Cloud Storage. And although I have set all the configurations and there was no issues regarding the configurations. So in my case, there was no issue from my side or my code. The issue was with the configuration of Google Cloud Storage with our project platform. So the Google Cloud Storage has been given access to a specific service account, and onto that service account, there was a restriction that it can be accessed from only one particular environment. and that particular environment was not supposedly was able to access by any external network. So my local code was an external network for that storage. So where it was given access to was our deployment cluster, where we used to deploy our code. So with the same erroneous code, when we deployed to our cluster, it started working fine, because from that particular cluster, it has the connectivity to Google Cloud Storage. So this could happen. It is not necessarily that always your code is wrong. It is also necessary to have a broader idea that what we are dealing with. So these were few issues that I thought, because that such kind of issues usually amuse people, that what is going wrong, is my code wrong, or what all I'm in case I'm missing something. But actually it's not always your code. You should have a better understanding of what you are building, where you are building, and where you are trying to deploy the code, especially in big data. So that was all for this video. Thank you guys for watching this. Please hit that like button if you really did. And please subscribe to GK Code Labs if you have not already done. Thank you guys. See you later.